Hello guys, today we will discuss about the protein analysis method, and it is very very important lecture for those students who want to analyze protein. So if you like that video, please subscribe that channel. So first of all, we discuss about protein. Protein may be defined as the high molecular weight mixed polymer of alpha minus set joined together with the peptide. Or you can say protein are the heterogeneous group of organic compounds which are made up of different sequences of amino acids linked by peptide. So we can analyze that protein, crude protein, in various methods. First of all, we will see the old methods like Jelgal and Dumas method. Dumas method is the more advanced method for the crude protein analysis. They are very simple and very useful method for protein analysis. Here you can see there is a Jelgal method where you analyze the protein, its protein content, crude protein content with the Jelgal apparatus. So first of all, you burn the substance, mostly protein containing substance, with potassium sulfate, copper sulfate, and concentrated sulfuric acid. This copper sulfate is used as a catalyst, and potassium sulfate is used to increase the boiling point, and concentrated sulfuric acid is used for the burning process. During this reaction, the protein which is present in the substance is converted into ammonia, and then it is changed into ammonium sulfate. So ammonium sulfate is produced during this reaction. Then we will go for the distillation and titration process. In distillation, we use sodium hydroxide to produce ammonia, and then we titrated with HCl to produce ammonium chloride. So this is very useful method to measure the content of a crude content of a protein. First of all, protein is digested with the sulfuric acid to produce ammonium sulfate, water, and carbon dioxide. During distillation, this ammonium sulfate is converted into ammonia with sodium hydroxide. Then it is titrated with the quart 1 normal HCl. So the HCl consumed during this titration method represent the crude protein content. If there is a lot of consumption of HCl, it means it produces lot of crude. It has a lot of crude protein. So if 30 ml of HCl has been reacted with ammonia to produce ammonium sulfate, so we can put these values in the formula, which is the amount of nitrogen present in volume of ammonia is equal to 14 over 1000. Why 14 over 1000? Because 1 liter contains around 14 gram of nitrogen. 1 liter of ammonia contains 17 gram of ammonia, or 14 gram of nitrogen. That's why we divide 14 by 1000. When we want to analyze the nitrogen present in the ammonia. So then we multiply how much volume is used during the titration method, then what is the normality of your acid. So by applying this formula, we can find out the amount of nitrogen present in the volume of ammonia. This is the specific formula for 1 liter, and this is the volume used during titration. So how much HCl is used and what is the normality. Then we can easily find out the percentage of nitrogen, weight of nitrogen multiplied by 1000 divided by weight of substance. then we can find out the percentage of protein by multiplying the this nitrogen percent with nitrogen factor 6.25. So this will provide us the crude protein. In this way, we can easily find out the crude protein content in a protein. We can see one video to understand the gel-dial process. Here you can see here is gel-dial method. It is the analytical chemistry tool for the quantitative determination of crude protein. So ammonia is ultimately measured by applying formula. John Geldahl discovered that process. How does it work? You have to take 0.8 gram of copper sulfate. This is specific for 1 gram of protein. This is specific for 1 gram of protein, 0.8 gram. This is specific for then you have to take 7 gram of potassium sulfate for 1 gram of protein. Then you have to take 1 gram of protein, sorry, substance which contain protein, sample which contain protein. Here you can easily analyze the, this is 1 gram of your sample. Then we will add these things in the gel-dial flask. Potassium sulfate, copper sulfate, and 1 gram of protein. Then you add around this is your copper sulfate, this is your copper sulfate, potassium sulfate, and then sample. Then you have to add a 12 ml of concentrated, which is around 98% sulfuric acid for the destruction process. Then you provide a 420 degree centigrade temperature for 1 hour to 2 hours. This ammonium sulfate then titrated with ammonium sulfate is produced. Here you can see copper sulfate is used as catalyst. Potassium sulfate is used to increase the boiling point and H2SO4 for the destruction of the sample. Here ammonium sulfate is produced, then it is distillated with sodium hydroxide to produce ammonia. And then ammonia is titrated with 0.1 normal HCl. Here you have made the distillation solution. Ammonium sulfate solution moved into the that flask. During distillation process, ammonia and sulfate is converted into ammonia. Here you can see the ammonia ion produced. And that ammonia is titrated with the 0.1 normal HCl to find out the actual crude protein content. First green color, then other color, then color will be finished. This is very useful method to find out the concentration of the protein. Then we have advantages of this method. What are the advantages of this method? Applicable to all types of food, inexpensive method, accurate and official method for food protein content determination, has been modified like micro gel doll method to measure the micro quantities of protein. And these micro gel dial operators are very efficient and they give the very early result. Disadvantage, measure total organic nitrogen, not just protein nitrogen. So that is the main disadvantage of gel dial method. It is also time consuming process. It take around 2 to 2.5 hours for this analysis. Poor precision than bivalent method, crossover reagent are used. So you have to handle with the goggles and surgical gloves. Then very very important method for the nitrogen combustion combustion method, Dumas method. Dumas method we use two gases. One is oxygen, which is used for the burning at high temperature around 1000 degrees centigrade, and other is carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is used to cool down the apparatus after the reaction. So in this method you burn the sample with oxygen at high temperature, then nitrogen is and ammonia nitrogen and nitrogen oxide are produced. So these nitrogen oxide are converted into nitrogen by the reduction method in the column of copper. So copper reduction column produce nitrogen from nitrogen oxide. So in this way, nitrogen is then measured with the detector, which tells us of the nitrogen content of the protein. Then it will multiply with 6.25 to tell us of the good protein percentage. Procedure: sample are weighed into the tin capsule and introduced to the combustion reactor in the automated equipment. The nitrogen release is measured by built-in gas chromatograph at high temperature on 600 degrees centigrade. So here is sample in A column. It is combustion into nitrogen oxide, and in the reduction chamber it contains copper reduction tube which produce nitrogen from nitrogen oxide. Then detector, here is the GC column. Then there is a detector. GC column detects the nitrogen present in the sample. Then it tells us in the form of peak in the detector, and this will show the nitrogen content. Then it also multiply with 6.25 to tell us for the good protein content. Application: the combustion method is an alternative to the Jaldal method and is suitable for all types of foods. Advantages: require no hazardous chemical, but it can cause damage if there is some kind of leakage of heat. Can be accomplished in 3 minutes, and it is very quick process. I have used that instrument. It is very quick process. Disadvantages: expensive equipment is required. Very very expensive equipment, and the process, this method is very abrupt, but it is expensive process. By your total organic nitrogen, not just protein nitrogen, just like Jaldal method. Then there is a protein assay method. One is bivalent assay, Lowry assay, and then bisynchronic acid assay. Pyruvate assay. What happens in pyruvate test? We use copper sulfate and the copper ion make coordinate covalent bond with the peptide bond in the protein, and it will produce purplish violet color, which gives maximum absorption at 540 nanometers. So if there is more protein, then the more purplish violet color is produced, then there is a lot of absorption at 540 nanometer if the sample contains more protein. So in this bivalent region, we use sodium hydroxide, sodium potassium tartrate, which means copper sulfate, So this sodium potassium tartarate is used to stabilize the copper ions and also prevent the reduction process in the highly alkaline pH. So copper sulfate, this bioreactor agent, if there is no challenge side, then we cannot store for longer periods of time. Procedure very simple. You have to take 5 ml of bioreactor agent, then you have to add 1 ml of protein, which contains 1 to 10 milligram of protein per ml. Then you have to wait for 15 to 30 minutes. Then you will go for the filtration or sanctification before reading absorption is required if the reaction mixture is not clear. A standard curve of concentration versus absorption is constructed using wine serum albumin. All the assays must require a standard curve to analyze the protein, to find out the concentration of protein. So what is standard curve, we will see in the video. This bioreactor method is very easy method, and it will also contains very less chemical substances to make that reagent. First of all, we will see, and that standard curve is uniform for almost all protein assays. We will see the how we can make the standard curve, and it is very useful to find out the accuracy of our spectrophotometer. Here you can see, for making standard curve, you have to make a reagent blank which contain only reagent. Then you have to make a lower concentration to higher concentration protein. If you want to analyze protein, then you have to make the solution of protein from lower concentration to higher concentration. And if you want to analyze glucose, then you have to make standard curve of glucose, like many method of glucose analysis. So in first tube, you have to add only reagent, then low concentration of protein, then higher than previous one, then higher than the maximum concentration. So you can make that lower concentration solution by using you can make the lower concentration of your protein by applying a dilution formula. So low concentration of protein give low value of absorption. With increasing concentration of protein, the purplish violet color get dense, and there is a high value of your protein absorption of protein. So here you can see increasing trend of absorption by the increasing concentration of protein. So this is also used to find out the accuracy of your spectrophotometer or photometer. If there is an increasing regular and increasing trend is seen by increasing the concentration of your standard, then you can see your spectrophotometer is working well. And if there is some variation there, that you can have some defects either in the lamp or either in the your photometric devices. So first of all, we take the reading of blank and we auto zero it. Then you have to take the reading from lower concentration to higher concentration. So this will tell us both the concentration of protein, and there is a linear graph obtained after the analysis. There is a linear graph obtained after the analysis that will show the instrument accuracy precision. Here you can see with the increasing concentration of protein, the transmission is decreased. So that in this way we can easily make the standard curve. This standard curve is almost similar to all protein acids. Similar to all protein acids. Then what is the advantages of bioretrace test? Less expensive than gel-dal and it is rapid route. They take around 30 minutes. Very few substances other than protein in food interfere with the bioretraction. Does not detect nitrogen from non-peptide or non-protein source. That is the main advantage. In gel-dal and in Dumas method, there is also the data. Detection of non-protein sources. Disadvantage. Not very sensitive as compared to the Lowry method, required at least 2 to 4 milligram of protein per acid. Absorption could be contributed from the bile pigment if present. High concentration of ammonium salt interferes the reaction. So this is the main disadvantage of this. Then Lowry assay. Lowry assay is performed in the two-step process. In first step process, you use bioreact reagent. In the second step, you use Foley-Sioux-Carlty reagent. So you use two reagents in the Lowry assay, and it is more sensitive than the bioreact assay. Hope I can tell you. The standard curve procedure of all protein assays is almost similar, but the principle is different. They show different highest absorption lambda max with protein at a certain wavelength. So wavelength is changed for every assay, procedure will remain the same. So in Foley-Sioux-Carlty reagent, you use phosphotungstic acid and phosphomolybdic acid. These are the oxidizing reagent. In the Lowry method, combine the bioreact with the reduction of Foley-Sioux-Carlty phenol reagent by tyrosine and tryptophan residues in the protein. So this is method is specific for aromatic ring containing a minuser. The bluish color 12 is read at 750 nanometer. It means it gives a high sensitivity for low protein. Sorry, this is 650. My mistake, it is 750. Or 500 nanometer, low sensitivity for high protein. Procedure protein to be analyzed are diluted to appropriate range around 20 to 100 microgram. In bioreact region you use in milligram, but in Lowry assay you use in microgram. So procedure is same, 5 ml bioreact region, 1 ml protein, then you incubate for 10 minutes, then you have taken the freshly prepared colon reagent, then you incubate 50 minutes for 10 minutes, then you have taken the absorption at 650 nanometer, then you have to draw the standard curve to compare your result. Here you can see advantages, very sensitive, 50 to 100 times more sensitive than bioreact, 10 to 20 times more sensitive than to 80 nanometer UV absorption method. Relatively simple, can be done in 1.5 hours. Disadvantages, color vary with the different protein to be greater extent than the bioreact method. This is the main disadvantage. Color is not strictly proportional to protein concentration. Here you can find out the concentration of any protein in the sample by using any protein assay method, either bioreact assay, either it is a Lowry method or it is by simple method. So here is concentration of any protein in a sample, absorption of sample divided by absorption of standard multiplied by concentration of your standard. Let's suppose your absorption of your sample is 0.12 and absorption of your standard is 0.212. And you use the concentration of protein is around 12 microgram per deciliter. It means it is around 12 microgram per deciliter. And if you use 12 milligram, it is equal to 12 milligram per deciliter. Then by syncogenic acid by assay, this is also a very useful assay. And you measure the intensity of color at 562 nanometer. So in this method, you use copper ions in alkaline condition, which is similar to the principle of Biuro test. The cuprous ion then react with the apple greenish bisynconic acid region to form purplish complex. One cuprous ion is selected by two bisynconic acid molecules. So this is the variation and only purplish color is produced during this reaction. That's why the color intensity is measured at 562 nanometers. So it is also very sensitive method. And peptide bond of 4 minus 16, 16 tryptophan and tyrosine contribute to the color formation with bisynconic acid. So the specific protein can be analyzed, which contains certain bond of cysteine, cysteine, tryptophan, tyrosine for the color formation. Procedure, mix the protein solution with the bisynconic acid which contain bisynconic sodium salt, sodium carbonate, sodium hydroxide and copper sulfate and has pH around 11.25. Then there is incubation for 30 minutes, then at room temperature 2 hours, 60 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. Then you have to analyze at 562 against the standard concentration. Advantages, it is more sensitive than the Lowry and Biuro, and its sensitivity is around 0.5 to 10 micrograms. One step mixing is easier than the Lowry, so this is one step fraction. Disadvantage, color is not stable with time. The analyst needs to be carefully control the time for the detailing of absorption. Any compound capable of producing copper to cuprous ion will lead to the color formation, which is a main disadvantage of this test. Then ultraviolet 280 nanometer absorption method. This is the method is a UV spectrophotometer method in which you analyze the aromatic ring containing protein at 280 nanometer. Procedure, protein are solubilized in buffer RLG. Then the absorption of protein solution is read at 280 nanometer against the blood reagent blank. Then the protein concentration is calculated as the formula as we have shown to earlier. The effort is relatively sensitive at 280 nanometer, 100 microgram of or more protein is required. No interference from the ammonium sulfate and the buffer disadvantage. Why there is no interference of ammonium sulfate? Because it only measure the concentration of aromatic ring containing minus. Disadvantage is nucleic acid also absorb at 280, but at 260 nanometer, nucleic acid absorption is more. Aromatic minus content in the protein from various food sources differ considerably. That will give a different reading. The solution must be clear and colorless. Sterility due to the particulate in the solution will increase the absorption, which is a false result. Then diabetic binding method. There is an anionic dye which is used for the some dye is bound to the protein and free dye concentration is measured by using the spectrophotometer. The decrease in dye will cells are stored, the increased concentration of your protein. So the amount of unbound diet is inversely proportional to the protein content. If the unbound diet is very less, then it means protein is very high. It will make part with the diet, and the unbound diet, soluble diet, will pass the filter and so we measure the concentration of that diet with the spectrophotometer. So very easy procedure. Sample is finally grounded and added an excel dye solution with the known concentration. That dye will bind with the protein, and the remaining dye is filtered, and the concentration of remaining dye is measured. Advantages: rapid and expensive and relatively accurate for analyzing protein content in food commodities. No pressure reagents, does not measure non-protein nitrogen, more precise than gel dye method. Disadvantages: not sensitive, milligrams quantities of protein are required, not suitable for hydrolyzed protein due to the binding to the N-terminal binding. Then there is a method of protein characterization. This is known as SDS stage, in which we use different chemical like SDS is used to denature the protein. Known 1.4 gram of SDS bound to the 1 gram of protein. So what is the function of sodium potassium sulfate? It is a detergent which denature the protein and break its quaternary testy structure and scandi structure into a rod shaped structure, so it can easily run on the surface of the gel. So another useful parameter of sodium potassium sulfate, it gives negative charge to the protein. So it moves on the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis on the basis of their molecular weight. Why? Because sodium sulfate gives net negative charge to protein, and it moves from cathode to anode side. So this SDS is the amphipathic and detergent, so it is easily denatured protein into rod shape. Here you can see rod shape protein. And there is two gelling tails are used for the polymerization, for making gel. One is acrylamide, which makes a straight chain polymerization, and then this acrylamide, which makes a cross link polymerization. Here you can see straight chain polymerization, and then you can really see cross linking with the basic acrylamide. So in SDS you denature the protein with SDS and beta mercaptoethanol to make into the rod shape to easily run on the SDS sodium potassium sulfate polyacrylamide gel electrode. Reagent required 30% polyacrylamide gel solution, which means it contains 29 gram of acrylamide and 1 gram of basic acrylamide. Then you have to take 1.5 ml trace buffer pH 8.8 for resolving gel, and 1 molar trace pH 6.8 for staking gel, and 10% SDS solution. Then you have to prepare freshly prepared ammonium sulfate 10%. Then this is used as a catalyst in the polymerization process. Then you have to also use to tamid, which is also used to remove the free radicals in the gel. So it is a stabilizing gel and increase the polymerization process. So here are the gel: 40% or 30% basic acrylamide trace buffer, then water, SDS, ammonium sulfate, tamid. You have to make 8% running gel or resorbing gel and 5% staking gel. In staking gel, you have to use the buffer of 6.8 TN, and in running buffer, in running gel or dissolving gel, you have to use a buffer of 8.8 TN. In staking gel, it is it can contain less concentration and protein, and you can easily move on the staking gel and stake at the dissolving gel, and you can easily move to the dissolving gel on the basis of their molecular weight. Buffer, sample buffer, trace buffer to provide the appropriate pH, SDS to denature protein, threshold to make the protein sink into the wells, so it can easily move over the surface of the polyacrylamide gel and so then bromophenol we know dye to visualize the sample. Then you add this sample buffer to the protein solution and then heat at 95 degrees centigrade for formant to denature the protein. After the denaturing the protein, then you have to load on the gel. After so that you have to cast the gel, you have to use 10% or 8% dissolving gel and 4.5% staking gel. Prepare the separation gel solution by combining reagent. Do not add ammonium sulfate and diamond, otherwise it will make your gel solid early as your program. So you have to add 50 centimeter at the last. So load the gel to polymerize for 20 to 30 minutes. Then you have to put prepare the staking gel. Mix all the reagent except 80 centimeter. First of all, you have to add a dissolving gel. Then you have to add a staking gel when there is less phase left in the gel casting phase. Mix the APS and diamond and treat it with the isopropanol with the step of filter paper. Why we use the isopropanol? To make the upper surface of the dissolving gel linear. So then add APS and diamond to make the solid stacking gel. Then you have to place the comb and you have to wait for 10 to 20 minutes to solidify the gel. Then you have to load your sample on the gel with the microfiber with the micro tubes. So run at 200 volts for 30 to 40 minutes. Then after 30 to 40 minutes, you have to place the solution gel in the staining solution, which contains 0.25 gram of mesothelin blue dye and 90 ml of methanol and 10 ml of water. Then 10 ml of glacial acetic acid, prepare and vertex it. Then you have to filter the your staining solution with Wattman filter number 1 and to remove the all impurities present in the dye. Then you have to place the your gel into staining solution that will make the protein band prominent. Then you have to add your gel into the staining solution. It will remove the color from the mesothelin blue dye from the water gel, and gel become clear, and the only dye bound to the protein will be clear. So application to identify whether particular protein is pure or not, separation of protein prior to western blot transfer, species identification, antigenics preparation to measure genetic diversity, and also to characterize the protein by western blot. After separation with STSP, you have to analyze to western blot by using primary antibodies, secondary antibodies, and you have to use alkaline phosphatase to produce color product which quantify the protein present and the SDS phase. Then evolution of protein we will see in the next lecture Monday. On Monday, we will see the isolation method. Briefly, we discussed the isolation method. One is the homogenization method, in which you then the fractionation method, then localization method, then centrifugation method, then salting out method, dialysis method, column chromatography method, and many other method. In chromatography, you use ion exchange chromatography, size of solution chromatography, affinity chromatography. In detail, we will see in the next lecture. Cell content is centrifuge at a low speed. It will separate high molecular weight subcellular organelles like nuclei and cell debris. Then you increase the speed at 20,000 RPM. It will remove mitochondria, peroxisome, lysosome. Then you increase the speed. It will remove microsome. Then it will clear solution. It will cytosol at high speed. So microsome has the lowest molecular weight. That have high molecular, that are the highest. So that low at low speed, high molecular weight molecules are separated. Here you have seen the column chromatography, in which protein can easily be separated. Here you can see the gel filtration method, in the which high type molecular will elute first, then low molecular weight elute last. In this way we can purify that. Then this is also size of solution chromatography. We can also use ion exchange chromatography, cation exchanger and anion exchanger for polar molecules. And by using different solution method, the purity level of protein will increase. That's all. On Monday we will see the isolation method in more advanced form and more explained form and in video form. So if you like that video, please subscribe that channel. Keep on.